All That I Have by Laurent Joffrin. Read by Michael Maloney. The life that I have is all that I have, and the life that I have is yours. The love that I have of the life that I have is yours and yours and yours. A sleep I shall have, a rest I shall have, yet death will be but a pause, for the peace of my years and the long green grass will be yours and yours and yours. Anonymous. Chapter 1. I first met Princess Noor in a beam of moonlight. It was not under a stone balcony to the strains of a mandolin, or in the languor of a tropical evening with a glass of gin clinking in my hand. It was on the 16th of June 1943, in the smelly cabin of a Lysander flying low over the sea to occupied France. For a good hour, all I could see of my companion on this mission was a profile, rather like something on a medal, a shadow delineated by the moonlight. As we climbed into the aircraft at Tangmere, I had scarcely had time to shake her hand in the darkness. Then we had taken off without a word, deafened by the roar of the engine, gripping the armrests of our leather seats. As we neared the French coast, the Lysander banked westwards to avoid the anti-aircraft guns at Cherbourg and headed for the less fiercely defended coast of Brittany. The light, which had until then been projected to one side of her, suddenly lit her face up fully, and a Middle Eastern beauty appeared before my eyes. She had smooth dark skin, a graceful mouth, black hair falling over her shoulders, and her huge dark eyes looked at me, betraying her fear. A shy smile lit up her face. Her lips quivered. Noor was frightened, and she was trying to hide the fact. I was so struck by so much loveliness that I returned her smile, but was unable to say a word. To give an impression of composure, we watched the silvery Brittany countryside scudding past beneath us. Then, overcoming my surprise and rapt admiration, I eventually managed to say something. Any attempt to sparkle was made impossible by my own shyness as much as the noise. A supreme effort of imagination did persuade me to bellow gruffly but politely, "All right." She turned to look at me again, and her smile widened while her eyes searched desperately for some shred of friendship. She brought her hand out of the folds of her coat and held up her first and second fingers, Winston Churchill style, forming a V for victory. I laughed with her, and pursued, still shouting, "My name is Sutherland," I said, "John Sutherland. I'm going to Paris to see Prosper." "Nora Wilson." And she offered me a fine, dark-skinned hand. Noor had been given orders never to give her Indian name, Noor Mysore Vijay Khan. Apart from the fact that this elision made things more simple, she was not to let people know her original nationality. She complied willingly. Some members of her family were in France, and the Gestapo would have been only too glad to have made use of them. The pilot had no trouble reaching the Loire, which he kept on his left to avoid the main towns. He was heading east, flying just 1,000 feet above the black countryside, turning only occasionally to check that the river was still there. "I'm going to Paris too," she said. "We're taking the same train at Angers. You're in first class and I'm in second. I'm a radio operator. I'm going to be working for cinema. You must call me Aurora. I'm going to be the Aurora transmitter." Cinema ran one of the networks within the vast fraternity that Prosper had set up the previous year. We were not kept in complete isolation in the SOE. We were allowed to tell each other a certain amount, so long as it would be of no use to the enemy. If we were arrested and one of us spoke, the Germans would glean that there were networks in Paris and the West, Prosper and Cinema. They actually knew this already. They would also learn that a new transmitter receptor had started operating in Île-de-France, the Aurora transmitter. But they would not have the vital information, the names under which Noor and I were operating, the names that appeared on our identity papers and which we would not disclose to each other. Noor suddenly looked straight at me, and her voice quavered as she asked, Do you think we'll come back? I found it impossible to speak, and my chest felt constricted. There had been a knot in my stomach since the day war broke out. The knot would unravel only on the day the Germans capitulated. It was fear holding me in its grip. Before joining the SOE, I had been second in command of a commando unit in the Special Boat Service. I had already fought behind enemy lines during the French campaign and in Libya. I had eventually learned to overcome the gnawing feeling which saps morale and drains the joy out of a face. But a girl like Noor, I hesitated. What could I say? Everyone in the SOE knew that agents sent to France had a 50-50 chance of dying there. In a classic infantry offensive, the attack would be called off if 10% of troops had been lost. We were a suicidal infantry unit. We had the worst deal in the war, with the added fear that if we were arrested, death might come rather too slowly. At night, we all dreamt about torture. So I did the only thing I could think of, what any man would have done in that situation. I put my arm round her shoulder. She huddled against me, shivering with fear. Several minutes later, as the paroxysm passed, she sat back up, biting her lip. I could see her fingernails digging into the palm of her hand. She drew away from me and stared through the steel-rimmed windscreen at the starry sky far above us. "I'm so sorry." And it was then, romantic English cretin that I was, perfectly impassive in my guise as a secret agent and succumbing to a gush of tuppenny halfpenny sentimentality, that I knew I would love her. The outline of the chateau at Angers slid under the wing, and a meander in the river glinted ahead of us. The Lysander lost height until it was skimming the trees. Before the arrival of the SOE, no RAF pilot would have wanted to fight in this cumbersome plane. It was so slow that it provided an easy target for the anti-aircraft defense. But the peculiarities of war had turned this fault into a feature. The Lysander had no competition when it came to landing and taking off with all the lights extinguished in a field or on a stretch of moorland, leaving the ground barely 300 yards after it had set off. As far as the resistance were concerned, it was the friendly bird that came on the night of the full moon. Three lights suddenly appeared on the shadowy ground, between the ghostly outlines of bushes. They formed an upside-down L. The Lysander banked around it, lined up along the long side, and slowed. Facing into the wind, which was standard procedure, the plane landed and bounced on the sloping surface of the Vieux Briolet, one of the SOE's airfields. It carried on to the second light, turned round and taxied back, then turned once more to face into the wind again, ready for takeoff. With a gun in his hand, the pilot scoured the darkness opposite the lights. He knew that the agents on the ground were supposed to wait along the right-hand side of the L. His orders were to open fire on anyone who approached from the left. We were to be met by Henri Blainville. I had met him in London before he'd set off once more without any fuss to risk his life organizing transfers for our agents in the Paris region. Blainville was a peerless pilot, enlisted in the RAF, and he carried out his every mission in the elegant and affable style he had adopted. Back in England, during a training course sometime in 1938, I had watched him hop out of his cockpit after some terrifying aerial acrobatics, as if he were coming away from a game of bridge, all smiles and chat, with his chestnut-brown hair neatly combed, and his blue eyes perfectly calm. One incident had established his reputation. On a winter's day, he'd been flying just above the channel heading for the cliffs of Dover during a demonstration, and the freezing temperatures had created a build-up of ice on the steering cables. The plane was heading straight for the wall of chalk, and the controls were not responding. In less than a minute, he would be crushed. Instead of frantically shaking the handle, as any other pilot would have done, Blainville stood up, to the astonishment of his co-pilot, and headed for the back of the plane. He opened a hatch and hammered the cables with a spark plug swivel. Then he turned round and gave the thumbs up. The co-pilot pulled on the handle, and the plane skimmed over the top of the cliff. Since the beginning of 1942, Blainville had been acting as travel agent for secret agents. There was not one landing or parachuting within a 200-mile radius of Paris that did not bear his signature, punctual timings, and a courteous reception. Three shadows appeared on the correct side.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.